The eight men in this room all have one thing in common. They all want to be the next president of the United States. And in 1984, one of them would receive the Democratic nomination for president. But winning the nomination would be the easy part. What laid ahead in the fall was the most difficult. His name, Ronald Reagan, one of the most popular incumbent presidents in history. HBO, the Heath Broadcasting Organization, is pleased to present another part of our series, Celebrating America. Today, a look back at Election 84. Here's a preview of today's show. We'll begin by showing you the first major debate between the eight Democrats running for president, an excellent study in our American political process in action. From there, we'll go to San Francisco in the Democratic National Convention, where candidates Gary Hart, Jesse Jackson, and Walter Mondale all try to lead and fight for their party's future. On to Louisville, Kentucky, for the first of two major debates between incumbent President Reagan and challenger Fritz Mondale. We'll analyze the political commercials of 1984 and why the Democrats chose a more negative approach, and the Republicans and President Reagan took the high road for a more positive campaign style. On to election night. Reagan would win by one of the largest electoral victories in history. The next morning, Walter Mondale would try to analyze why he lost by the margin he did.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
And to conclude our program today, we'll take a look at a short collage of some of the many memorable events surrounding Inauguration 1985. I'm your host, Jim Heath, and we're broadcasting today from Lake Havasu City. And we begin on Wednesday, November 7th, 1984.
In the course of the campaign in the last few weeks, it began to dawn on you that you would probably lose to the president.
I knew it was tough from the very beginning. No one who campaigned around the country could see the reality of what was going on could have doubted that, and I knew it was going to be tough. I felt that our convention may have been the most successful in history. For a while, I thought that that had changed the landscape, but within a few weeks, we were back to about that tough level. After the first debate, I thought we had a chance and things moved again, but then it moved right back to that other level. I would say that that my chances of winning probably disappeared at the end of the second debate. My feeling was that if we'd had the same kind of verdict, which I doubted we'd have in the second debate, that I then had a chance to win. But the president did sufficiently well in the second debate that I think it reassured Americans, and they did what I think they were planning to do all along.
That was Walter Mondale, the Democratic presidential candidate in 1984, the day after he lost that election. Good evening, I'm Jim Heath, and we're coming to you from the Heath Broadcasting Studios. Tonight, as a part of our Celebrating American series, we take a look back at Election 1984. We officially begin our program tonight by going back to February 1984, one of the first major encounters between the eight Democrats running for the presidential nomination. Meanwhile, on the Republican side, President Reagan was running unopposed Republicans were united behind his re-election efforts.
Vice President Bush and I would like to have your continued support and cooperation in completing what we began 3 years ago. I am therefore announcing that I am a candidate and will seek re-election to the office I presently hold.
But the Democrats were fighting, not only as candidates, but as philosophers. They each wanted to dictate and determine the future of the Democratic Party. On one hand, you had the more conservative element, like John Glenn and Reuben Askew, and on the liberal side, you had the George McGovern and Jesse Jacksons. And then there were those other candidates in between. This is before the New Hampshire primary. Gary Hart had not become a household name. Very few people knew who he was. John Glenn was the second runner. Walter Mondale was in the lead, and many people felt that the nomination would be a contest between Glenn and Mondale. And one final note about this debate. It's an excellent study in our American political process in action. You had the more conservative elements fighting the more liberal elements, and the Democrats eventually chose a more medium candidate. Sit back now. Each of the scenes we're going to show you throughout the evening will be prolonged, so you'll get a taste of what the events were really like. And now, one of the first major debates between the Democrats in February 1984.
Mr. Mondale, you said you want to balance the federal budget. Besides eliminating waste, what else will you do to bring that about?
I would do several things. First of all, I'd scale the defense budget to reality. Secondly, I would impose a very strong program of health care cost controls. Thirdly, I would administer the agriculture budget, which has been criminally handled by this administration and now costs some $20 billion or more when it's never cost more than $5 billion in the past. I can administer that in a way to bring those costs down dramatically. I think we need to restore revenues, and I have a specific proposal that would increase and restore revenues progressively so that the people of great wealth, the large corporations that have gotten away with murder, while the average American's taxes have gone up, would have to join the rest of us. And I would make other cuts, but I would also add something in terms of education and science, in terms of promoting the competitive force structure, and also in terms of restoring some fairness in American life. I've worked this out carefully, and I have pledged, and I can achieve it, to reduce the Reagan deficits by more than half.
Let me point out, that's the same vague gobbledygook of nothing we've been hearing all through this campaign. Let's just get with it. Let me say something here. There wasn't a single figure attached to that except we're going to reduce it by half. I've put out a very specific program. Other people have here, too. This gentleman that just made that statement here, and I like Fritz, he's a fine man, but when you go before labor and you promise you're going to match foreign governments subsidy for subsidy, dollar for dollar, and the cheapest estimate we can get on that is $50 billion. Reuben Askew, who was special trade representative, estimates it's $130 billion. And then you go before other people and you promise them everything else. Is this going to be a Democratic Party that promises everything to everybody and runs up $170 billion a year? Let me finish. $170 billion a year that will only help put more people out of jobs. That's ridiculous. If we're going to balance this budget, it's going to come as we do the things that I've proposed, where we cut the budget and where we go on a pay-as-you-go system, where we have a surtax, where we have defer that indexing. That's the way to it, not going out promising everything to everybody and then not even bothering to go through the checkout counter. I'm disgusted and tired of all the vague promises. I wish that the former vice president would, in fact, get some figures down so they can be compared with what the rest of us are proposing.
The first point, Mr. Glenn, is that the reason we have $200 billion deficits is that you and some others voted for Reagan.
No, I'll tell you why
hold
it is.
I'll tell you why it is.
It's because your administration gave us 21% interest rate, 17% inflation rate.
Who has the floor?
And that's why we lost the White House, and it's why we lost the Senate.
Mr. Munder.
Wait a minute.
You said
now.
It was free flowing.
Wait a minute now. Mr. Donahue, may I have your... There's just been about a 6-minute speech, all of it baloney. And I would like to have 6 minutes to answer. Just a minute. Mr. Glenn voted to create these $200 billion deficits that we're suffering from. He wants to add the B-1 bomber.
He voted for poison nerve gas, and he tries to attack my specific proposals that will reduce the federal deficit by more than half.
Nothing
by
specific
voodoo.
About him.
Now, wait a minute. Now, by voodoo numbers. For example, let me tell you how he gets up to his figures. I proposed $11 billion for education. He says it's 50. I proposed to put Americans back to work. He said, oh, you want to hire everybody on the federal payroll. Those are baloney figures. My position is responsible, and we're doing just fine.
Can I make one statement?
Okay. What I'd like to say is you're both right.
To the right.
You know, they're both right in what they say about each other. You will have
to... Phil, I think, one, you know, as Democrats and the nation looking at us, we have to conduct the affairs of this business in a serious vein. That's important. And it is serious. And secondly, it is important that unless we're going to challenge the corporation to pay their fair share of taxes and deal with the military budget, which we dealt with for 2 hours, we cannot reduce the budget. The Republicans cannot sit home and enjoy this because they created this budget with their Reaganomic tax proposal. I would hope that before we finish today, it's not just enough for us to offer aid and programs to poor people. We must empower poor people to aid themselves. Now, to that extent, so long as the Voting Rights Act of 65 is not enforced across the South, it means you will not get equity amongst blacks, Hispanics, women, and poor people in the Congress, in the legislatures, in the judiciary, where these decisions are made, in fact. Unless that Voting Rights Act is enforced, you'll never get ERA passed, and that's critical because 70% of all poor children live in a house headed by a woman. Unless that passes, you'll not end right-to-work laws so people can get paid the work that they do. So I want some focus here on lifting the boats at the bottom. The blacks, the Hispanics, the women, the Asian, the locked out must be empowered and not just embellished.
Fritz, John, here you two go again. The fact of the matter is this party will not regain leadership so long as the leaders of the past continue to debate whose policies of the past were the worst. Unless we offer some new ideas and some new leadership and recognize the fact that the decline of American industries occurred before Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan didn't invent deficits, he just compounded them. Our party has made some mistakes, and quarreling between the two of you as to whose mistakes were the worst are not going to win the election or govern.
Most of the candidates started spending most of their time in New Hampshire, the site of the first major presidential primary. Gary Hart felt that it was inevitable that he was going to do well, and he was saying so long before the press caught on.
I think it gets down to whether you're going to play the game that a handful of politicians and the people who report on their activities say you ought to, or whether you're going to leapfrog that and do it differently. And maybe there is some risk involved, but I've been kind of a high-risk candidate all my life. If I didn't take any risks, I wouldn't be here.
Gary Hart would win New Hampshire, and the campaign would begin.
It appears tonight that Senator Gary Hart is on his way to a clear-cut victory over Walter Mondale, and that would really shake up this race for the Democratic presidential nomination.
Many people thought, including the front runner, that this campaign would be over tonight. This campaign just begins tonight.
Good evening, I'm Jim Heath, and welcome to the Heath Broadcasting Network's first political show of the 1984 election season. Well, this is Super Tuesday 1984, a night that is going to thin out some of the Democratic candidates. Stay tuned, a special report is next.
Good evening from the NBC News Super Tuesday election headquarters tonight, where the big winners are Senator Gary Hart and former Vice President Walter Mondale. You're looking at Senator Hart now with his wife, Leah, who's in, dressed in red there, and that's Congresswoman Pat Schroeder, also of Colorado. Just to his right, it's a very close ally of his in Colorado and in Democratic Party politics altogether. That's Senator Gary Hart at his headquarters in Washington tonight. Let us show you how well he is doing, especially in the northeastern part of the United States, where he has already chalked up victories in New Hampshire, Maine, and Vermont. Tonight, you can add the state of Massachusetts. 53% of the precincts reporting in. Gary Hart with 39% of the vote. They change even as we speak, but not very much. He'll win in Massachusetts quite effectively over Walter Mondale. George McGovern running third there tonight. And in Rhode Island, 80% of the precincts reporting in the state of Rhode Island. Gary Hart with nearly 50% of the vote that has been counted. Walter Mondale with 37% of the vote. 89% of the precincts reporting in. Walter Mondale had to do well there, and he did. 31% of the vote, as you can see. Senator Gary Hart finishing second with 28% of the vote. Jesse Jackson now up to 20%. That's important for him. If he stays there, he'll continue to get federal matching money. And that can be important fuel. As a California legislator once said, it is the mother's milk of politics. John Glenn back in fourth place in Georgia with 19%. In Alabama, nearly 70% of the precincts in. Walter Mondale, the winner in Alabama, 34% of the vote. Gary Hart with 23%. John Glenn with 23%. And Jesse Jackson running fourth in Alabama, 19% of the vote, doing well, especially among young black voters, not so well among older black voters. And now we have standing by at his Washington headquarters tonight, Walter Mondale. He's there with the big NBC News Decision 84. So I gather you're very happy based on everything that we saw, but let's break it down objectively. Just 2 weeks ago, it looked like you had a lock on the South,
that's
Mr.
Right.
Mondale.
That's right.
Now you've won in two of the states down there. You've lost the biggest one in terms of the popular vote, and Gary Hart was running very strongly second in both of those states.
Well, let me just say one thing. First of all, there was no question in the early part of the nominating process, the general presumption was that this was a 100-yard dash and I was going to win it.
That was your presumption, wasn't it?
No, that wasn't mine, but that was the general presumption. That fell apart in New Hampshire. Then the presumption was it was going to be a 100-yard dash for Gary Hart. That ended tonight. Now what we've got is a marathon, and that guarantees the American people what they're entitled to, the debate about what the difference is. Who is Gary Hart? Where would he take the country? How experienced is he? What are the differences? Who would make the best president? And what was happening these last two or three days, the debate really started in Atlanta, is that once those issues were out, once we were compared, I was picking up strength.
Let me ask you something, Mr. Mondale. You've had some very tough things to say both to and about Gary Hart in the past week or so. Do you really believe that Gary Hart, as president, would be heartless and without compassion, and that he would be naive in dealings with the Soviet Union?
Well, Tom, why don't we start with what I said? I said if you compare Gary Hart's record with mine on the issues of social justice, on standing up against powerful special interests to fight for that average American family, there's no comparison, and there isn't. If you compare my record on arms control and what my experience and what I'm proposing to do, which is sensible and doable around the principle of the freeze, with the some seven inconsistent positions that Gary Hart has taken, you contrast a powerful position on arms control backed by experience with a position that's uncertain and weak. Now, those are the facts. And that's what the American people need to know. This is not a personality contest. We're dealing with the future of our country, and we need a president who will keep us secure and safe, restore our competitiveness, and restore a sense of fairness. That's what I'll do.
Mondale, let me ask you about your ties to organized labor, which helped you tonight in Alabama, by the way. But overall, so far in this primary season, there is some evidence that organized labor and its leadership has been a liability to you. Do you regret now that you got that endorsement as early
and as prominently
as you did?
Not a bit. Since when should someone apologize for having the support of working men and women? I'm my own man. As President of the United States, I'll lead this country. And I'll say no to organized labor. I'll ask them to do things, to sacrifice along with everyone else. But the working men and women of this country have taken a real hosing from the Reagan administration, and they've got some rights too. And as President of the United States, I intend to stand up for them as well as all other Americans.
Early on, one of your media consultants said that you dare to be cautious. My impression is in the last 10 days or so, that Walter Mondale has taken the gloves off a bit and you're a lot more comfortable with your more freewheeling style.
Look, we've got the debate that we should. If I made one mistake, Tom, it was for 6 weeks, Senator Hart was taking shots at me, saying things about new versus old, the future versus the past, all bunk, and I wasn't answering any of it. And the result was that some of it stuck. Now we're having that debate. And in these last two or three days since that debate started, I'm picking up strength, because the real question is who's going to be the best president, and I'm going to win that debate.
How much do you give credit to your new campaign motto, Where's the Beef?
That's helping a lot. There's no beef there. When I hear your new ideas, I'm reminded of that ad, Where's the Beef?
Yeah.
How did you like it when this AFL-CIO began talking about Where's the Beef? A nice big fat hamburger roll, but no beef.
Well,
What do you say?
I showed the beef last night in Mobile, Alabama. Actually, I had two buns and a copy of my book. The book is 176 pages long, and it's got a lot of beef in it. And what I said was that I think a lot of people don't like that beef or can't digest it because it's not grown on special interest cattle.
Senator, a lot of our exit polls show that you have the least amount of strength tonight among people who are looking for experience and who are looking for stability in a crisis. Now, that's a very important vote come November. What can you do to overcome that?
Well, we have however many months there are, 8 or 10, for me to, for this campaign to settle down and get into some very serious discussions about the depth and breadth of our commitment and our policies on arms control, on approach to foreign policy, not just east and west, but north and south, international economics, economic redevelopment here at home.
Can I interrupt for a second? Isn't
sure.
this campaign going too fast for that now?
Well,
I grant you this campaign was meant to keep people like you out of this sort of race.
That's right. Well, it's been going too fast up to tonight, and now it begins to slow down, and I am happy about that, frankly. This business about running on media and momentum is just nonsense. I was against the so-called front-loading from the beginning, and I am very happy now that we're going to get into a period where we have one primary a week, and hopefully we can debate some issues.
But it means you and Mr. Mondale are going to be fighting each other all spring and maybe half the summer instead of the president.
Well, I'm not fighting Mr. Mondale. I'm fighting for the future of this country and contesting with Ronald Reagan. I'm not.
You tell him, come on. You mentioned media. I'm surprised to hear you say that you're not interested in the media thing.
No, I didn't say
that. It was very clear you ran a media campaign.
I didn't say that. I said that what I'm trying to dispel is the myth that this is a campaign based only on momentum and media. It's a campaign based on ideas.
A lot of questions have been raised in the last few days about yourself and the way you've defined your character, your age, your name, your naval career, etc. You've got to overcome that clearly now. How do you begin doing that?
Well, first of all, that concern, to the degree it exists at all, seems to exist almost exclusively in Washington. I don't hear a lot of American people talking about those issues. I think character, personality, background is all legitimate. People want to know who is attempting to lead their country and perhaps the free world. I welcome it. I have nothing to hide. There's nothing in my background I'm ashamed of.
No October surprise.
No.
Politicians always worry about that in all
Not
parties,
me.
In all campaigns.
Not me.
I think it's fair to say that the results of today's election were mixed and provided the very clearest indication yet that our party still has a horse race on its hands.
I said 2 weeks ago here in Boston that if I did not place first or second in this important primary race, that I would withdraw from the presidential competition of 1984, and that is what I intend to do.
Perhaps it is fitting tonight that we do leave our broadcast listening to both candidates McGovern and Senator John Glenn, which you just saw. Truly, they are spectacular and great men in political history, and especially during this year's presidential campaign, but their time just isn't going to be this year. That's the way it looks right now.
One more, President. You're going to drink the whole thing? Then we have some questions.
If I did, it would be the first time they've given me that much time.
Behind me is a memorial that symbolizes the Ranger daggers that were thrust into the top of these cliffs. And before me are the men who put them there. These are the boys of Puente Hope. These are the men who took the cliffs.
Celebrating the 23rd Olympiad of the modern era, I declare open the Olympic Games of Los Angeles.
We'll be right back.
the Democratic convention. Most people agree that Mondale will receive the nomination, but both Hart and Jackson have enough delegates to cause Mondale some problems with the platform.
On the night before Democrats open what they hope will be 4 days of orchestrated harmony, Walter Mondale and his top staff are trying to dig out from under an unwanted and unexpected mess. Even before all these empty seats are filled with thousands of Democratic delegates, this 4 years in the making production is opening on a note of news, at least news of sorts. As the vanguard of the cast of delegates got an official hello from the host city and host mayor, Dianne Feinstein, tonight, Walter Mondale apparently reversed himself. He certainly decided not to replace the Democratic National Chairman, Charles Manatt. Mondale, over the weekend, apparently had tried to replace Manatt with Georgia's Burt Lance. That ran into such opposition from Union and Western elements of the party, among others, that Lance was named General Campaign Chairman instead. Still, Mondale apparently wanted Manatt out, but after a weekend of haggling, it was announced this afternoon that Manatt will stay on after all.
Well, I think we can still come out of this very united. I think it was unfortunate that at a convention where we were going to stress unification, that we had some of the distress over who was going to be chairman there for a couple of days, but I'm sure we can survive that, and I doubt that 15 or 20 years from now, political historians are going to look back and see that as a determining factor in what happened this year, so I think we have that behind us.
The overwhelming wave of satisfaction with the selection of Geraldine Ferraro is going to be the history-making story that comes out of this convention.
The president's going to be very popular in Nebraska, and it'd be very difficult to beat. I'm not sure that anybody can beat it, but I think that Geraldine Ferraro brings a sense of excitement to it, a sense of newness to it. And I think she's an individual people trust.
Well, below the surface, there is still hope lurking in the hearts of Jesse Jackson and Gary Hart that Walter Mondale's train might be derailed.
We have been reporting that Mr. Mondale, at least earlier today, was looking for some way to stand up to Jesse Jackson at this convention.
I don't think it involves Jesse Jackson. I think the minority planks, or the Jesse Jackson planks, would destroy this party if they were adopted in terms of an election. I believe that this country, most blacks, most whites are against racial quotas. I believe they believe in a strong defense. The platform planks that are seeking to be amended would reduce defense, would, in effect, require racial quotas. I don't think that that's helpful to the party.
I've been especially proud to be a Democrat. As our party went through the most open and competitive primary process in American history, we fielded 8 fine candidates, and any one of them would represent an improvement over the incumbent.
Although Mondale, Hart, and Jackson were considered the highlights of the Democratic convention, there was a new name on the horizon. His name was Mario Cuomo, and he was the governor of New York. And most people agree that of all the speeches that were given through that 4-day convention, Cuomo's was outstanding.
We believe as Democrats that a society as blessed as ours, the most affluent democracy in the world's history, one that can spend trillions on instruments of destruction, ought to be able to help the middle class in its struggle, ought to be able to find work for all who can do it, room at the table, shelter for the homeless, care for the elderly and infirm, and hope for the destitute. And we proclaim as loudly as we can the utter insanity of nuclear proliferation and the need for a nuclear freeze, if only to affirm the simple truth that peace is better than war because life is better than death.
A moment ago, Britt, there's an enormous difference between setting pulses pounding on the convention floor among the delegates, which Governor Cuomo clearly did, and putting aside all the differences that in fact have divided these three men.
If you look at it realistically for a moment, I think that you'd have to agree that nearly all the major platform rules and credentials issues that confronted the Democrats after the primary season have been resolved, not all of them, but nearly all of them, and that given the circumstances of the beginning of this convention, Mr. Mondale's choice of a very popular running mate, and so forth, that it would be very difficult for either Mr. Hart or Mr. Jackson to be the one who comes in and is a stick in the mud in all of this.
Weeping has endured for a night, but now joy cometh in the morning. Our time has come. No grave can hold our body down. Our time has come. No lie can live forever. Our time has come. We must leave racial battleground and come to economic common ground and moral higher ground. America, our time has come. We've come from disgrace to amazing grace. Our time has come. Give me your tide. Give me your poor, your huddled masses who yearn to breathe free. And come November, there will be a change because our time has come. Thank you and God bless you.
This campaign has sought to touch that unique idealism that identifies us as Americans, to keep alive the belief that each person can make a difference. For I see an America where greed, self-interest, and division are conquered by idealism, by the common good, and by the national interest. I see an America too young to quit, too courageous to turn back, with a passion for justice and a program for opportunity. An America with unmet dreams that will not die.
By choosing a woman to run for our nation's second highest office, you send a powerful signal to all Americans. There are no doors we cannot unlock. We will place no limits on achievement. If we can do this, we can do anything.
I want to be a veterinarian because I like to help animals.
I want to be a fireman so I can save people and put out fires.
I want to be a teacher.
I don't know.
I want to be an astronaut.
I guess the one thing I really wanted to be when I was a kid is a pilot.
To play on Night Rider.
I used to go out to the Blue Earth Airport and watch planes take off. If I could only be a pilot.
I want to be a baseball player.
I was on the squad, football squad in Elmore. I was captain my senior year. And, you know, it's a matter of pride, and we played very hard, and we had a fair record.
What'd they call you?
Crazy legs.
I want to be a dietitian.
Well, it was very heady stuff. In other words, my dad and my mom taught each of us we could be anything we wanted to be. All we had to do was be honest and work for it.
I want to be president.
Why?
Because it's fun.
What I learned during the campaign was how important the family really is.
That's
what he's doing.
Joan, Teddy, Eleanor, William, they all just pitched in and helped each other out. We all seemed to grow a little bit.
That one's brown. Take a little one over. Here's the big one. All the press would ask, when was the last time the whole family was together? Yeah. And it was New Hampshire.
I think, New Hampshire.
That was a good togetherness.
That was fun. Yeah.
Well, we love to be together as a family. Picnics and fish fries that we've had all through these years.
It's the time when we all come together again, when we're making the meal.
He's an expert when it comes to cooking fresh fish, and we're experts at eating them.
If you can fry fish, then you could also play Atari.
Think so?
Yeah.
Well, how come I did so miserably then?
Because it's your beginning try.
Was there any signs of hope?
No.
Whether with his family or on the job, Walter Mondale is real. Ever since his early days in the Senate, his has been a leadership of hard work, good preparation, tough action, and no bull. One day when he was chairman of the Senate Subcommittee on Children and Youth, the famous anthropologist Margaret Mead testified saying, "As our children go, so goes the nation." The day had a profound effect on the young senator. He took action, and it wasn't long before he had become known as the Children's Senator. Child Nutrition, Head Start, the Elementary and Secondary Education Act. These things had the Mondale stamp on them, and Mondale made a difference. Today, his convictions about our children's future are stronger than ever.
We got to have better education, more emphasis on learning, and investment in science and pure research, the things that go into the future. You know, we always say a mind's a terrible thing to waste. Well, now we can't afford to waste it.
Walter Mondale has reached out to touch the lives of many of us. Last year, Barbara Opaki drove him through her neighborhood. There had been a lot of sadness here.
It wasn't until 1979, two wells were discovered contaminated with 20 to 30 solvents, cleansing materials, TCE, chromium, lead, other toxic materials. This house here is one. Jimmy Anderson died in 1981. A 2.5-year-old baby died in 1982 from leukemia after having been diagnosed at 6 months. And this is his home.
I think it was a tough thing for Walter Mondale to walk in and try to communicate with these people. It's not an easy thing to do. And there's nothing that you can say that's going to replace that child. They want someone that cares enough, will do something so that there are no more Woburns.
Long before that visit to Woburn, Mondale had done something. He fought for the federal Superfund to clean up toxic waste. He fought the lobbyists whose clients had for years just dumped and run. The Superfund passed. Mondale had made a difference. But since 1980, the Superfund has hardly been used at all. And 8,000 toxic dump sites are still here.
If there's any community that understands how damaging the deficit can be, it's the business community.
Whether he's at a morning staff meeting on the road or at a rally of 10,000 in Cleveland, Walter Mondale faces the tough issues head on.
I'm not talking about the politics of what the financial community talks about. I'm talking about the underlying realities of an economic policy. We have to bring the deficit down dramatically, and I will, and we must invest in the future at the same time. You can't put America's future on hold or a deep freeze for 5-10 years. You have to do both, and that's what my budget does. It reduces the rate.
In the long fight for a fair America, nobody's ever had to ask which side Fritz Mondale is on. In consumer protection, in demanding foreign trade policies that work for Americans, in fair taxation, Walter Mondale is an expert for the people.
Enormous theft from the next generation.
Taxes are unfair on the average worker, the average family, as they are, with enormous relief to the very wealthy and to big corporations, while people, $30,000 a year or less, all taxes considered, they actually went up. That's too bad. Well, I don't agree with that. I think taxes, we need to take the pressure off of middle America. Their idea is to cut Social Security or Medicare. Well, those old folks didn't get any help the first time around.
That's all they've got in life. Why do we have to pick on them? They say, well, why don't we raise taxes on the average American? Well, that average American didn't get any help the first time around.
But they're betting nobody will figure that out. Nobody will understand
it. They're betting that the American people aren't smart.
That's right.
It's a bad bet.
In countries all around the globe, the United States has had no better advocate than Walter Mondale. Mondale knows the world, and he knows its leaders. Whether in China, where his negotiating skills opened up dramatic new avenues of trade, or in Vienna, where he emphatically laid the human rights issue on the line in a confrontation with the government of South Africa, or in Manila, where he spoke out boldly for democracy and negotiated to keep our two largest overseas military bases, or in taking his role in bringing Egypt and Israel together in the days before the historic Camp David Accord. Walter Mondale has made a difference. An army man, an attorney general, a U.S. senator, and first in line to become commander-in-chief, Mondale has had a remarkable preparation for the most powerful responsibility in the world. On the day that this man becomes commander-in-chief, the world will see an active, dedicated approach to arms control and an immediate pursuit of a mutual, verifiable freeze. He will be searching for peace, not drifting toward war. A steady hand, a savvy negotiator, a tough realist. He will direct, not delegate, the most awesome issue of our time. And there will be a difference.
Dad always taught us that we had a duty to make America better and to help others. That's supposed to be what America's all about. Every child ought to have a chance to fulfill his or her dreams. I want to make our nation and our world safer. I want to make it more hopeful. And I believe that's what a president's for.
Mondale and his acceptance speech before the 39th Democratic National Convention at Moscone Center in San Francisco. A straightforward statement of a man as he is, not flamboyant. Mainstream Democrat, protege of Hubert Humphrey, child of the era of FDR politics in this country.
We are living on borrowed money and borrowed time. These deficits hike interest rates, clobber exports, stunt investment, kill jobs, undermine growth, cheat our kids, and shrink our future. Whoever is inaugurated in January, the American people will have to pay Mr. Reagan's bills. The budget will be squeezed, taxes will go up, and anyone who says they won't is not telling the truth to the American people. I mean business. By the end of my first term, I will reduce the Reagan budget deficit by 2/3. Let's tell the truth. That must be done. It must be done. Mr. Reagan will raise taxes, and so will I. He won't tell you. I just did.
After a long primary campaign, the Democrats would unite. But in the back of all their minds, they knew that their greatest challenge was still ahead.
It again, right? You see the sign?
Yes.
In your heart, you know he's right?
Yes, in your heart, you know, that's right. Now, that's what they say about him, and that was his slogan of the campaign in 1964, and he will translate that into 1984 terms.
May I remind you that one of the most famous sentences he uttered in 1964 when he accepted this party's nomination was, "Extremism in the defense of liberty is no vice."
And we may hear that again tonight.
We may.
Actually, that we're just teasing with you. That part of the speech has been released, although the rest of it has not. There was some discussion as to whether some of the party people wanted him to use that line, but he's going to use it. He is, after all, Barry Goldwater.
A month ago, I sat in my den and watched the Democratic National Convention. Speaker after speaker promised the moon to every narrow, selfish interest group in the country. But they ignored the hopes and aspirations of the largest special interest group of all, free men and free women. So tonight, I want to speak about freedom. And let me remind you that extremism in the defense of liberty is no vice.
Tired of the spend tax policies of the past, and we need to get the balanced budget amendment to the floor of the House, and we cannot do that unless we elect Republicans to Congress in November of 1984.
Governor Rhodes, right now the state house is in the hands of the Democrats in Ohio. How is President Reagan going to do in your state?
I think President Reagan has a good opportunity here in Ohio. If these people can stop talking about 88 and 86 and we probably have 25 candidates for president in 1988. What they do, they destroy the enthusiasm for President Reagan, and also they dry up a great deal of money that's going to come in to help the Republican Party.
My guess is that the president is going to open up a lead between now and November wider than he has now, and that he will carry Illinois. But it means that all of us Republicans have to go back, work very, very hard to register the Reagan-Bush voters. There's a lot of them unregistered, to get their votes cast on November 6th and to guard the ballots. You know, we've had some problems in Chicago in years past. The sanctity of the ballot in Chicago is not the highest.
Ladies and gentlemen, my fellow delegates, Americans all, I now proudly place a nomination to serve the people, the united people of these United States, the name of our now and future president, Ronald Reagan.
To be that America's future belongs to the wishers, the wasters, the wanters, the whiners, and the weak.
That the election could be won on the basis of gender insults
our electoral process. We are thinking women. No platitudes will buy us. No party will inherit us. No candidate will own us.
Years ago in Detroit, I pledged my total dedication and energies to support our president, and that has been a very easy pledge to keep. Tonight, I pledge again my every effort to support President Reagan as he leads this nation into four more years of prosperity, opportunity, and peace.
Prepared to take the constitutional oath.
I am.
Place your left hand on the Bible and raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
Morning, Jim.
And will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend.
And will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Now, congratulate you, sir.
Yes, it was quite a day. A new beginning.
You know, you don't really become president. The presidency is an institution, and you have temporary custody of it.
I know that the image is that it's a very lonely job, and you're out there all on your own for everything that has to be decided or done. That's not quite true. I've always believed that the other people around you here are meant to be here and to contribute. And you know that the best counsel and the opinions, and many times varied opinions, opposition as well as approval of whatever's being discussed, that you're hearing these honest views from these very capable men and women who have given up so much. So many of them in their private lives to come here and serve. You don't feel alone. I believe that the Vice President, George Bush, is more involved in policy matters of this administration, government in general, here in the executive branch, than any Vice President we've probably ever had.
It's just different. The mood is different. It's not that everybody agrees with what you're doing, but there's a certain respect for the United States of America, and it is loud and it's clear, and I run into that all over the country. People say, you know, we're pleased the president's taken these strong positions, and they might argue with you on one or two things if you gave them a chance, but it's back. You get the feeling that the country's moving again, a certain pride level.
The bottom line with President Reagan is that he has brought back respect for the White House. Period. That's it.
There's a whole new attitude in America today, and I think that needs to be continued.
It used to be the Americans took it for granted they were American. Now it seems like they're really proud.
I feel more patriotic towards my country, and I feel more proud to be an American.
He put me to work. He's going to keep me there. The man did a good job, and I hope he's going to go for another 4 years. God bless America.
I even hear songs on the radio, TV now, says I'm proud to be an American.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living. still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today.
There's been a lot of talk about a reawakened patriotism in our country and in our military. There's now a renewed sense of pride and patriotism there, too. We recently were on a trip to Asia. On Sunday in South Korea, I went up to the demilitarized zone, went to the outdoor church service with our troops there.
Bow our heads together for the invocation.
I met with a great many of the men and had a chance to talk with them individually. I was so proud to hear not grumbling or I want to go home, but to hear the pride with which they carry out their duties there.
It looks good.
And I have never seen such morale, such esprit de corps, such pride in their work. All of us here at home should remember all those young men and women on the frontiers of freedom.
PB2 Michaels from Elkton Mound.
I hope that people out there recognize what a wonderful bunch of young people we've got in the military now. When they see someone in the street in uniform, I hope they'll go up and say hello and maybe tell them they're a little proud. Proud to know you.
Proud to know you too, sir.
The president's policies, I'm 100% behind because he's strong and his strong defense.
I think President Reagan is getting us back to basics, back to things that keep our nation surviving and strong, like a good defense and a good economy.
The economy has never been as great as it has been now in 20 years. Unemployment is down, interest rates are down, more people are buying homes than ever before.
I really feel that we're going to be better off in the long run.
We're on the upward swing, and the factories are working much stronger than before. The people are getting back to work.
People are traveling more, business is better, people are on business trips, people are on vacations. They're spending more money.
We're back on top.
You know, it's hard to believe that it was less than 4 short years ago that interest rates were going through the roof. Inflation was, of course, the single biggest culprit and was responsible for those high interest rates. But you can understand why tackling inflation head-on was one of our first priorities. And we went at it tooth and nail and brought it down. And we've kept it down. That wasn't wishful thinking, and it did become reality. Since January of 81, the prime rate has been pared by 40%. Mortgage interest rates have come down 4 percentage points since their peak. Now, that makes home ownership possible for 17 million American households that couldn't afford it just 2.5 years ago. And the same goes for automobiles, too. Lower loan rates have made cars a lot more affordable for a lot more people. Still, it is good to see people buying homes and cars again, to see America's automobile industry regaining its strength and taking a backseat to no one. So, we're going to keep on with what we're doing. We're going to bring those interest rates down further by keeping inflation down once and for all.
I think he's just doggone honest. It's remarkable. He's been on television, what have I heard, 26 times, talking to us about what he's doing. Now, he's not doing that for any other reason than to make it real clear. And if anybody has any question about where he's headed, it's their fault. Maybe they don't have a television.
I've made a commitment, not just as president, but as a senior citizen myself, that we must have a Social Security system that keeps its promise to the people who kept their promise to America.
The president has done a lot of things, but bringing inflation down, I think, is probably the best thing he's done for older people, for everybody.
I feel strongly about keeping inflation down, interest rates down, but also
making sure that no one pulls the rug out from under those people who are dependent on Social Security.
I know that President Reagan is a caring man, that he cares about old people and children and ill people.
There is no threat from anyone, certainly not from this administration, to Social Security.
I didn't know I was shot. In fact, I was still asking, what was that noise? I thought it was firecrackers. And the next thing I knew, Jerry, Secret Service, had simply grabbed me here and threw me into the car, and then he dived in on top of me. And it was only then that I felt a paralyzing pain, and I learned that the bullet had hit me up here. When I walked in, they were just concluding a meeting in the hospital of all the doctors associated with the hospital. True, when I saw all those doctors around me too, I said, I hope they were all Republicans. I've been asked about a visitor that I had while I was recuperating back in March of 1981, Cardinal Cook. He was a wonderful man, a most dedicated man, and just one of the most kindly men that I have ever met. And we were talking about some of the, call them coincidences, that had happened at the time of the shooting and that I had heard after I'd started to recover. And he said that in view of them, God must have been sitting on my shoulder. Well, he must have been. I told him that whatever time I've got left, it now belongs to someone else. Our trip to Japan, Korea, and later to the People's Republic of China makes you realize that the old line, go west, young man, go west, still fits. There's a new frontier out there. There is a future. And the United States is going to be very much a part of that future. One cannot meet with those people without realizing that they are tremendously capable people, a talented, energetic people. And I found that there was a great longing for peace among those people. I think that we can have a fine relationship. We do already. But we can keep that and build on that relationship. Whether it's with trade, cultural exchange, we can be mutually beneficial to each other. We stand on a lonely, windswept point on the northern shore of France. But 40 years ago at this moment, the air was dense with smoke and the cries of men, and the air was filled with the crack of rifle fire and the roar of cannon. Here in Normandy, the rescue began. At dawn on the morning of the 6th of June, 1944. 62 of the Rangers who scaled the cliffs there at Pointe aux Hope, now back 40 years later to the scene of their heroic action.
These are the boys of Pointe aux Hope. These are the men who took the cliffs.
It was a very moving experience. They were what General Marshall called our secret weapon, the best damn kids in the world.
Where do we find them? Where do we find such men? And the answer came almost as quickly as I'd asked the question. Where we've always found them in this country. On the farms, the shops, the stores, and the offices. They just are the product of the freest society the world has ever known.
Someday, Liz, I'll go back, said Private First Class Peter Robert Zanatta of the 37th Engineer Combat Battalion and first assault wave to hit Omaha Beach. Lisa Zanatta Hen began her story by quoting her father, who promised that he would return to Normandy. She ended with a promise to her father, who died 8 years ago of cancer, I'm going there, Dad. And I'll see the beaches and the barricades and the monuments. I'll see the graves, and I'll put flowers there just like you wanted to do. I'll feel all the things you made me feel through your stories and your eyes. I'll never forget what you went through, Dad, nor will I let anyone else forget. And Dad, I'll always be proud. Through the words of his loving daughter, who is here with us today, a D-Day veteran has shown us the meaning of this day far better than any president can. It is enough for us to say about Private Zanata and all the men of honor and courage who fought beside him four decades ago, we will always remember. We will always be proud. We will always be prepared, so we may be always free. I believe in the line, I look to the hills from whence cometh my strength. Before I reached my decision to run for re-election, some people thought that maybe I'd be happy to retire to that beautiful ranch outside Santa Barbara and spend the rest of my life enjoying the simple things, riding horses, chopping wood, and spending time with Nancy, being outdoors and close to all of God's natural gifts. But they forget. There are so many things that remain to be done, so many challenges that must be met. I'd have felt like a quitter if I'd just walked away from getting federal spending under control once and for all, or from reforming and simplifying our tax system, or creating enterprise zones, a set of incentives that would encourage business to help rebuild the troubled areas of our country, provide hope to those who yearn for true opportunity. And something else. Sitting in the Oval Office, you look around and sometimes you can't help but choke up a little bit because you're surrounded by history that somehow has touched everything in this room. And it occurs to you that every person who ever sat here yearned in the depths of his soul to bring people and nations together in peace. Four times in my life, America's been at war. Such a tragic waste of lives. That it makes you realize how desperately the world needs a lasting peace. Just across the hall here in the White House is the Roosevelt Room, named after the two Roosevelts who served here, one a Republican, one a Democrat. Many decisions are made in that room, and often as I meet with my staff, I gaze up at the five service flags, each representing one of the five military services, and draped from each flag are battle streamers, signifying every battle campaign fought since the Revolutionary War. Each ribbon a remembrance of a time when American men and women spilled their blood into the soil of distant lands. My fondest hope for this presidency is that the people of America give us the continued opportunity to pursue a peace so strong and so lasting that we'd never again have to add another streamer to those flags.
Government should do all that is necessary, but only that which is necessary. We don't lump people by groups or special interests, and let me add, in the party of Lincoln, there is no room for intolerance. and not even a small corner for anti-Semitism or bigotry of any kind. Many people are welcome in our house, but not the bigots. The poet called Miss Liberty's torch the lamp beside the golden door. Well, that was the entrance to America, and it still is. And now you really know why we're here tonight. The glistening hope of that lamp is still ours. Every promise, every opportunity is still golden in this land. And through that golden door, our children can walk into tomorrow with the knowledge that no one can be denied the promise that is America. Her heart is full. Her door is still golden, her future bright. She has arms big enough to comfort and strong enough to support. For the strength in her arms is the strength of her people. She will carry on in the 80s unafraid, unashamed, and unsurpassed.
Well, Mondale had received the nomination, and he began his campaign. After choosing Geraldine Ferraro, he had literally made history, selecting a woman as the second top position for our national government. The campaign would begin slow, but it would pick up steam after the first presidential debate held in Louisville, Kentucky, between the incumbent President Reagan and Mondale. Mondale would do remarkably well, and the president would do very poorly.
The other day, Vice President Bush disclosed his tax returns to the American people. He's one of the wealthiest Americans, and he's our vice president. In 1981, I think he paid about 40% in taxes. In 1983, as a result of these tax preferences, he paid a little over 12%, 12.8% in taxes. That meant that he paid a lower percent in taxes than the janitor who cleaned up his office or the chauffeur who drives him to work. I believe we need some fairness, and that's why I proposed what I think is a fair and responsible proposal that helps protect these people who've already gotten no relief or actually got a tax increase. Mr. Reagan, after the election, is going to have to propose a tax increase. And you will have to compare what he proposes, and his Secretary of the Treasury said he's studying a sales tax or a value-added tax. They're the same thing. They hit middle and moderate-income Americans and leave wealthy Americans largely untouched.
Mr. President, let me try this on you. Do you think middle-income Americans are overtaxed or undertaxed?
You know, I wasn't going to say this at all, but I can't help it. There you go again. I don't have a plan to tax or increase taxes. I'm not going to increase taxes. I can understand why you are, Mr. Mondale, because as a senator, you voted 16 times to increase taxes. Now, I believe that our problem has not been that anybody in our country is undertaxed. It's that government is overfed. And I think that most of our people, this is why we had a 25% tax cut across the board, which maintained the same progressivity of our tax structure in the brackets on up. And as a matter of fact, it just so happens that in the quirks of administering these taxes, those above $50,000 actually did not get quite as big a tax cut percentage-wise as did those from $50,000 down. From $50,000 down, those people pay two-thirds of the taxes. And those people got two-thirds of the tax cut. Now, the Social Security tax of 77, this indeed was a tax that hit people in the lower brackets the hardest. It had two features. It had several tax increases phased in over a period of time. There are two more yet to come between now and 1989. At the same time, every year, it increased the amount of money. Virtually every year, there may have been one or two that were skipped in there, that was subject to that tax.
Today, it is up to about $38,000 of earnings that is subject to the payroll tax for Social Security. And that tax, there are no deductions. So a person making anywhere from 10, 15, 20, they're paying that tax on the full gross earnings that they have after they have already paid an income tax on that same amount of money. Now, I don't think that to try and say that we were taxing the rich and not the other way around, it just doesn't work out that way. The system is still where it was with regard to progressivity, as I've said, and that has not been changed. But if you take it in numbers of dollars instead of percentage, yes, you can say, well, that person got 10 times as much as this other person. Yes, but he paid 10 times as much also. But if you take it in percentages, then you find out that it is fair and equitable across the board.
Now, Mr. President, you said there you go again, right? You remember the last time you said that?
Mm-hmm.
You said it when President Carter said that you were going to cut Medicare. And you said, oh, no, there you go again, Mr. President. And what did you do right after the election? You went out and tried to cut $20 billion out of Medicare. And so when you say, there you go again, people remember this, you know.
But let me help you with the difference, Ms. Ferraro, between Iran and the embassy in Lebanon. Iran, we were held by a foreign government. In Lebanon, you had a wanton terrorist action where the government opposed it.
Let me just say, first of all, that I almost resent, Vice President Bush, your patronizing attitude that you have to teach me about foreign policy. I've been a member of Congress for 6 years. I was there when the embassy was held hostage in Iran, and I have been there, and I have seen what has happened in the past several months, 17 months, with your administration.
For one of the few times during that campaign of 1984, some people believed that perhaps the polls would close, and that indeed Mondale might have some sort of chance against the president. But then there was the second debate, held 2 weeks later, and this time, the president would do well.
Welcome to the Music Hall in Kansas City. They're calling it the main event, the second presidential debate on foreign policy and national security. Walter Mondale is billing it as perhaps the most important night of this campaign, perhaps even for the nation for the rest of this century. For Walter Mondale, it could be do or die. He may have to score a decisive victory here like he did 2 weeks ago in Louisville if he has any realistic chance of winning this election. For President Reagan, a tie could be as good as a win. His advisors believe that if the president holds his own, just improves over his faltering and disappointing performance over 2 weeks ago, then he'll be able to hold on to his substantial lead in many of the polls.
Mr. Mondale, many analysts are now saying that actually our number one foreign policy problem today is one that remains almost wholly unrecognized, massive illegal immigration from economically collapsing countries. They are saying that it is the only real territorial threat to the American nation state. You yourself said in the 1970s that we had a, quote, hemorrhage on our borders, unquote. Yet today you have backed off any immigration reform, such as the balanced and highly crafted Simpson-Mazzoli bill. Why?
This bill imposes upon employers the responsibility of determining whether somebody who applies for a job is an American or not. And just inevitably, they're going to be reluctant to hire Hispanics or people with a different accent. If I were dealing with politics here, the polls show the American people want this. I am for reform in this area, for tough enforcement at the border, and for many other aspects of the Simpson-Mazzola bill. But all my life, I've fought for a fair nation, and despite the politics of it, I stand where I stand, and I think I'm right. And before this fight is over, we're going to come up with a better bill, a more effective bill that does not undermine the liberties of our people.
It is true our borders are out of control. It is also true that this has been a situation on our borders back through a number of administrations. And I supported this bill. I believe in the idea of amnesty for those who have put down roots and who have lived here, even though sometime back they may have entered illegally. With regard to the employer sanctions, this we must have that, not only to ensure that we can identify the illegal aliens, but also, while some keep protesting about what it would do to employers, there is another employer that we shouldn't be so concerned about. And these are employers down through the years who have encouraged the illegal entry into this country because they then hire these individuals and hire them at starvation wages and with none of the benefits that we think are normal and natural for workers in our country. And the individuals can't complain because of their illegal status. We don't think that those people should be allowed to continue operating free.
President, I want to raise an issue that I think has been lurking out there for 2 or 3 weeks and cast it specifically in national security terms. You already are the oldest president in history, and some of your staff say you were tired after your most recent encounter with Mr. Mondale. I recall yet that President Kennedy had to go for days on end with very little sleep during the Cuba Missile Crisis. Is there any doubt in your mind that you would be able to function in such circumstances?
Not at all, Mr. Truitt, and I want you to know that also I will not make age an issue of this campaign. I am not going to exploit for political purposes my opponent's youth and inexperience.
One of the interesting aspects of analyzing an election year is trying to determine who's ahead in the polls and who's behind. And you can usually make this determination by taking a look at political commercials. The candidate running the negative ads is behind. The candidate running the positive part of the campaign is usually ahead. And in that case, it was true. President Reagan decided a more positive approach. Walter Mondale attacked, and on election eve, attacked even more.
Teach your parents well. Their children's hell will slowly go by. Don't you ever ask them why. If they told you, you would cry. So just look at them and sigh.
May no longer pretend that the quest for disarmament is a sign of weakness. For in a spiraling arms race, a nation's security may be shrinking even as its arms increase.
John F. Kennedy knew that it took strength and vision to control nuclear weapons. He turned this important idea into action in 1963 by signing the Atmospheric Test Ban Treaty with the Soviets. 4 later presidents signed 15 arms agreements with the Russians. But Ronald Reagan opposed them, proposing always to build more. With 7,000 new nuclear weapons in 4 years, Reagan now plans to take the arms race into space, an irretrievable step, preparing for Star Wars, not knowing where it will lead.
When you could keep Star Warring it, I never suggested where the weapon should be or what kind. I'm not a scientist.
Well, that's what a president's supposed to know, where those weapons are going to be. If they're space weapons, I assume they'll be in space.
That's exactly where they'll be. Killer weapons in space, layer upon layer, orbiting with a response time so short there'll be no time to wake a president. Kennedy's hotline will be obsolete. Computers will take control. The cost, $1 trillion. And Reagan plans to turn over the technology to the Russians. Mondale won't.
I don't believe this administration understands how most Americans feel about arms control. We know that if those bombs go off, that's probably the end. It's over. We're the first generation to have the capacity to destroy all life. And that's why this is not just another problem, it's the problem. I've been involved in every arms control fight over 20 years. I know what I'm doing. I've dealt with the Soviets. I've worked with our friends. I know how to get arms control. We must have that kind of leadership in the White House.
And that's the kind of leadership you'll get with Mondale, an Army man, senator on the National Security Council, vice president. He knows the world for the tough place it is, that we need a growing, strong defense, state-of-the-art conventional weapons on land and sea. He also knows, like Jack Kennedy, that we must deal with the Russians from strength. A steady hand, a savvy negotiator, he's ready to take on the negotiations that will stop weapons in space.
I want your generation and all generations in American history to get the very best. I want you to learn. I want you to challenge yourself. I want you to stretch that mind. I want you to think of new things and dream of new dreams. I want your life to be thrilling, and I want to help you.
The future stands before us. We must choose which kind it will be. A future with killer weapons orbiting above us, or the promise of a better future. It's not too late if we act now.
I say it's time for new leadership. It's time for America to move on.
Draw the line at the heavens on Election Day. No weapons in space by either side. Wherever you live in America, if you want to help the Mondale campaign, call this number right now. 1-800-258-6700. Thank you. It's morning again in America. Today, more men and women will go to work than ever before in our country's history. With interest rates at about half the record highs of 1980, nearly 2,000 families today will buy new homes, more than at any time in the past 4 years. This afternoon, 6,500 young men and women will be married. And with inflation at less than half of what it was just 4 years ago, they can look forward with confidence to the future. It's morning again in America. And under the leadership of President Reagan, our country is prouder and stronger and better. Why would we ever want to return to where we were less than 4 short years ago?
You want more for your kids than you had. And that's the American dream.
Mondale and Ferraro, bringing a new fairness to America. While Mr. Reagan tries to slash Medicare, they fight for seniors. While he forces 4 million people out of work, they fight for workers. And on tax breaks,
I refuse to make your family pay more so that millionaires can pay less.
They'll be taking the first step in a new direction for America. Mondale Ferraro, for your future. On a Friday, just a few weeks ago, the barber shop closed 3 hours early. The mill shut its doors at noon. And all across the state, people were taking time out for something special. A train carrying the 40th President of the United States and bringing with it a new spirit of accomplishment and optimism and pride. Because in the past 3.5 years, things have been looking up in the country. Today, the economy is up. Taxes and inflation are down. Americans are working again. And so is America. So, while some folks might have come so they could tell their grandchildren they saw President Reagan, most of them just stopped by to say thanks. President Reagan, leadership that's working.
1982. Reaganomics sinks our country into the deepest recession and unemployment in 50 years. Now Ronald Reagan says the economy is moving up. It is. Up on a mountain of debt and record Reagan deficits. More borrowing than all the other presidents in history combined. That'll drive interest rates up, slow the economy down, and then, if you're thinking of voting for Ronald Reagan in 1984, think of what'll happen in 1985.
There is a bear in the woods. For some people, the bear is easy to see. Others don't see it at all. Some people say the bear is tame. Others say it's vicious and dangerous. Since no one can really be sure who's right, isn't it smart to be as strong as the bear? If there is a bear.
After you work for a lifetime to pay off your house, you expect to be free and clear. But in another American house, there are plans today to put you $18,000 in debt, your share of Mr. Reagan's deficits. But when Mondale moves into the White House, he won't forget about your place. He'll cut spending, close tax loopholes, and put new taxes in a trust fund to pay off Reagan's debt. Let's stop mortgaging America. Mondale Ferraro, they're fighting for your future.
This place has a way of making us think about the kind of future our young people will have. Everything we do here, we weigh on tomorrow's scales. Keeping our economy strong and free from the terrible inflation of a few years ago will bring stability into the lives of those just beginning their families. Keeping taxes down and big government under control encourage creativity and economic freedom. These will expand new employment opportunities so important to those just leaving school for their first jobs. And keeping America strong and always searching for peace, well, nothing is more important than that. This magnificent house is 192 years old now. It stands watch on our stewardship, a guardian for future generations. What we do here may be important, but what we leave behind is even more important. I take no obligation more seriously.
President Reagan, leadership that's working.
CBS News coverage of Campaign 84 continues with 1 week to go. From CBS News Election Headquarters in New York, here is Dan Rather.
Good evening. 1 week to go and counting. President Reagan has every politician's dream, a huge lead in the polls. Walter Mondale's dream, a comeback from way back victory on Election Day. Just today, President Reagan came close to casting caution and his coattails to the winds, predicting a win so big and so decisive that his coattails could recut the cloth of Congress to one tailor-made for the Reagan program for the next 4 years and a Republican program for years beyond that.
I've been all over the country in these last few months, and I'd like to make a little prediction for you today. I believe that next Tuesday, we'll see a large number of voters joining our Republican ranks for the first time.
Walter Mondale, marching to the beat of a different pollster, campaigning from the heart and harder than ever, refusing to take any poll result but next Tuesday's. Counseling his supporters, don't let them take your vote for granted. Don't give up the ship of state.
Now, some of these pollsters and experts are saying the election is over, that your vote doesn't count. They have decided for you who your president is going to be, but I got a little message for them. Polls don't vote, people vote. And you're going to vote on November 6th for a change.
After a remarkably long campaign, from the selection of candidates in New Hampshire, through the conventions, and through the fall and up to Election Day, we finally reach that magic day, November 6th, 1984, and most people were surprised at the margin in which the president defeated Mondale.
Good evening. It is 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, and the polls are closed in 16 more states. ABC News wishes to project that Ronald Reagan has won in the state of Texas with its 29 electoral votes. The polls are still open in some parts of the states, namely in El Paso, and there is an important House race there where your vote will still count. No Democrat has won the presidency without carrying Texas. ABC News projects that Mr. Reagan has won in the state of New Jersey. The Republicans have won it in the last four presidential elections. ABC News projects Mr. Reagan is the winner in the state of Missouri with its 11 electoral votes. ABC News projects that Mr. Reagan has won in Tennessee. He won it only by half a point in 1980. He wins it again tonight. And ABC News projects that Mr. Reagan is the winner of the 8 electoral votes in Oklahoma, part of his western base.
Peter, with the additional states closed, there are now enough electoral votes voted on and floating around to choose a president. We now project Connecticut to have gone to Mr. Reagan with its 8 electoral votes. Kansas, for Mr. Reagan, 7 electoral votes by our projection. Maine, our projection is that Ronald Reagan has carried it, and it's 4 electoral votes. Delaware, our projection is that Reagan has carried Delaware with 3 electoral votes. And here's a big one, Illinois, Ronald Reagan, 24 electoral votes. Now, the first victory tonight for Walter Mondale in the District of Columbia. 3 electoral votes for Mondale. Peter?
The electoral vote for Mr. Mondale there in the District of Columbia, adding up 254 for Mr. Reagan, 270 needed to win. Mr. Reagan is 16 short. Mr. Mondale has 3.
This is ABC News coverage of the 84 vote from ABC News Election Headquarters in New York. David Brinkley and Peter Jennings.
Good evening. At this particular point of the evening, the polls are closing, as I think we said, in 16 more states around the country. And some, of course, have been closed for an hour and a half in some cases, and we have a couple of more projections to make. In the state of Massachusetts, ABC News projects that the Lieutenant Governor, John Kerry, has defeated Ray Shammy, the Republican. That was a place where Mr. Reagan went and campaigned rather fervently in the hope of getting Ray Shammy elected over John Kerry. ABC News projects that the former Lieutenant Governor, now the senator-elect, that was an open race because Paul Tsongas was retiring, now goes to the Democrats. ABC News also projects that Joe Biden is the winner of the Senate race in the state of Delaware. He is the incumbent there. His opponent was John Burris. Joseph Biden, who is considered a presidential candidate in 88, was running for his second term.
It's dinner hour at the Washington Square Bar and Grill, and if the camera can pick up this button, was an earlier button this year. It was Mondale Feinstein, if you can see that. And sitting with me is the mayor of San Francisco, the object of this button, Dianne Feinstein. You just heard the report, Mayor Feinstein. What happened to the woman's vote?
Well, I think that's a very good question. That hypothesized a gender gap, and that there were 9 million more women likely to vote. The question is, how in fact did they vote? The polls the week prior would suggest that the women voted for Mr. Reagan. And that will be analyzed. It will be cut apart 67 different ways. But I think there's one important thing. The Democratic Party took a very bold move. They made that move. It's tough duty to be a pioneer. It's very hard to be the first anything. And I think we've all got to give Geraldine Ferraro a big round of applause for a major, major effort and a very good performance.
Are you going to stay in the White House after the election?
Well, I've said I'm going to do what the president wants me to, David, and I have every indication that...
Jim, hold on. You will want to hear this. We now project the winner in Michigan to be Mr. Reagan, which gives him the electoral votes to make him president for a second term. It gives him a total of 274. Now, you don't always get news that good when you get on the television.
No, you're absolutely right, and that is superb news, and we haven't even gotten to the West yet, have we?
All right, now.
CBS News coverage of Campaign 84 election night continues.
CBS News estimates that Ronald Reagan has been re-elected president. The question remains, how big a mandate is he likely to get? Welcome back to our election coverage. The polls have just closed in 16 states with a total of 195 electoral votes in these states alone. On the basis of the results in those states and on interviews with voters as they left the polling places, CBS News now estimates that Ronald Reagan has been re-elected president of our United States. Until this hour, it takes 270 electoral votes to win. Ronald Reagan already has, as you saw on that, we estimate about 280. Now, up until this hour, President Reagan had all the states in red that you see here, 136 electoral votes. This is before we started counting these new votes in from the Midwest and from the South. This is how it looked before the polls closed in many states at this hour. Now, after the polls closed in the states at 8 o'clock, the electoral count began to grow. And of the states reporting this hour,
Of the 16 more states, Ronald Reagan has won 12 of these new states, putting his electoral vote total over the top with 280. Walter Mondale at this hour won one, the District of Columbia. Mondale has yet to win a state, but as expected, we estimate that he has carried the District of Columbia, which gives Mondale 3 electoral votes.
From the NBC News Election Center in New York, here is Tom Brokaw.
Good evening once again. I'm here with John Chancellor and Roger Munn, and we're watching a really phenomenal development tonight as Ronald Reagan continues to roll through the country. So far, Walter Fritz Mondale has won only the District of Columbia. All those states that you see behind me that are colored blue are the states that we have projected Ronald Reagan the winner in tonight. The polls remain open, of course. In the West and in the Pacific Northwest, that is Ronald Reagan territory, you still have the opportunity to vote there, not just for the presidency, of course, but for the many state and local issues that are on the ballot, as well as the congressional and Senate races that are at stake there. But if this trend continues, Ronald Reagan will be one of the most popular presidents of modern times. Remember that Dwight Eisenhower won by an overwhelming margin when he ran in 1952, a 55-44 margin. 4 years ago, Ronald Reagan won by a similar margin, and this time he may exceed Eisenhower's second reelection total. Here's the Electoral College vote as we have it right now. 405 votes for Ronald Reagan. He has exceeded the Electoral College total that his pollster, Dick Wirthlin, said that he would get, 400. Fritz Mondale with only 3. So that makes it an Electoral College landslide alone. And here's what's going on with the national vote. 27% of the precincts have reported in so far. The Reagan margin now has dropped a wee bit. It's down from 21, 22 points down to 18 points. It's still in the landslide proportions, but it has dropped 2 or 3 percentage points in the last hour or so as we count the national vote. We are keeping track of 13 governor's races tonight as well. We want to share some of those with you. Republicans have been doing well, but in the state of Arkansas, the Democrats, 38-year-old Bill Clinton, elected to his third term. Look at that boyish face, and he's already been in office 3 times in Arkansas. Elected once, then defeated, came back, and now he's been elected successfully to a second term in Arkansas. Jack Kemp is in Buffalo, New York tonight. He's the Republican congressman from that area. And in Denver, Colorado tonight, we have Senator Gary Hart, who is standing by. He, of course, contested Walter Mondale for the Democratic presidential nomination.
What we had was a personality contest. The president and his keepers and advisors kept him away from presenting any kind of a concrete vision for this country's future, any kind of a policy to reindustrialize America or to train our workers or to reverse the arms race instead of expand it into space. I think Ronald Reagan missed a wonderful opportunity to create a mandate for himself. He cannot go to the Congress now with any blueprint for this nation's future and claim that the American people voted for it.
Jack Kemp,
Tom,
what about that?
I strongly disagree with Gary Hart. It is so obvious that the things that the president was talking about were closer to the mainstream of what the American people want for this country. They want private enterprise growth, not more growth of the public sector, government. They want tax simplification and lower rates, something that Gary Hart and Walter Mondale have refused to talk about. And they want the Enterprise Zone bill passed to reach out to minorities and inner city people to get them back to work.
What do you think the chances are that 4 years from tonight we'll be talking about the two of you in this contest? Senator Hart?
Well, I think it's totally inappropriate to be discussing 4 years from now tonight. I think, first of all, Walter Mondale waged a very decent and courageous campaign. My hat is off to him. I worked hard on his behalf, and I'm very proud of his race and the kind of candidate that he was. Our party has a bright future. I don't think it's profitable at this point to narrow it down to individuals. I think there are going to be a lot of people coming forward as leaders of our party.
Well, I do agree with Gary on one thing he said tonight. This is not an appropriate time. This is time for him to praise Walter Mondale, and it's time for me, certainly, to give credit to a president and the vice president who waged a tremendous campaign and have really captured the heart and mind of a majority of the American people. And I don't want to rest until we capture the District of Columbia. That's how I feel.
Andrea Mitchell is at the president's reelection celebration in Los Angeles tonight, but there's been a somber piece of news that has been reported to the president about the shipment of Russian MiG-21s to Nicaragua. And Andrea Mitchell is there now with further details. Andrea, what do we know?
Well, so far what we know from intelligence sources, Tom, is that a Soviet freighter is tying up tonight at the port of Corinto in Nicaragua, carrying, we believe, the intelligence sources believe, 12 to 18 Soviet MiG-21 fighter jets. The administration views this as a direct challenge to its commitment, its pledge, not to tolerate Soviet MiG fighter jets in Central America.
One of the brightest lights in the House of Representatives this evening is in Atlanta, and we want to talk to him about what he thinks the future of the House of Representatives looks like. His name is Republican Congressman Newt Gingrich.
All I'm suggesting is it's very strange that the higher up the ladder you get, the more accurate public opinion polling is represented in terms of how people are voting. When you get down to the House, which is more complicated, more difficult, more gerrymandered, I think it's harder for the average American to have their will expressed in the House right now than it is either in the Senate or the White House.
And do me a favor, Congressman, when you go back to Washington, don't take that chair with you.
I will not do so.
In the state of Arizona, it has been voting Republican in presidential elections since 1952. 7 electoral votes there, Barry Goldwater country, but with the Democratic governor, part of the new breed. His name is Bruce Babbitt out there in Arizona. A lot of people think that he may be the future of the Democratic Party. And the big one, the biggest one of all on this election map, the home state of the President of the United States, California, 47 electoral votes. President Reagan, the winner in California. Mondale and Ferraro spent a lot of time and a lot of money in that state, had hopes that they could knock the president off in his own state, but tonight proves that they could not.
We asked him what he had to say to Walter Mondale, because although Mr. Reagan has never lost an election, he certainly lost primaries, and he lost the nomination in 1976. But he replied that he didn't think there was anything he could say that would make Mondale feel any better. But he said he wanted to reach out and sort of unify the country and reach out toward people who had not supported him in this election. So you get the sense that Ronald Reagan is not going to rub anyone's nose in it because of this huge landslide that he's getting, but instead is going to attempt to get everybody back into the fold so that he can try to push forward with that mandate he thinks he has.
He's on stage now. This is the first sign of life in this arena all evening. They've been waiting for a long time. It's been a really long campaign. He told his staff earlier in the evening to walk proud, that they had nothing to be ashamed of. But it was clear that most of these people were just not prepared for the enormity of this defeat.
A few minutes ago, I called the President of the United States and congratulated him on his victory for re-election as President of the United States. Please. He has won. We are all Americans. He is our president, and we honor him tonight.
The familiar flags that were so prevalent in both campaigns, that's young Ron Reagan and Maureen Reagan and her husband to her right there, and Patty and her husband to his right up on the stage. Triumphant moment for the Reagan family.
Thank you all very much.
That's the president's brother that you can see with the glasses in the background. Look at the hair in that family. I mean, he's older than the president.
I think that's just been arranged. We must continue not only into those next 4 years, but into the next decade and the next century to meet our goal of sustained economic growth without inflation and to keep America strong. Our society is a society of unlimited opportunity, which will reach out to every American and includes lifting the weak and nurturing the less fortunate. We've fought many years for our principles. Now we'll work to keep those principles in practice. That's what we have to leave to our children and to their children, and they are what this campaign was all about. We've come together again, we're united again, and now let's start building together and keep that prairie fire alive, and let's never stop shaping that society which lets each person's dreams unfold into a life of unending hope. America's best days lie ahead, and you know, you forgive me, I'm gonna do it just one more time. You ain't seen nothing yet. God bless you. Thank you all very much.
Right here, 4 years ago, we celebrated a great victory, a new beginning. And I remember saying to many of you here tonight that with Ronald Reagan as president, our country would soon be on the road to economic recovery at home and to peace overseas. And that was the promise of the new beginning in 1980. And it's because that promise was kept that we're here again celebrating a magnificent victory in 1984.
I'm sure, sir, that in retrospect, you were the best candidate the Democratic Party could have run against Ronald Reagan. Think that one of your opponents for the nomination, say Senator Gary Hart, might have been able to run better than you?
I did my best, and I worked my heart out. And I was the nominee of the Democratic Party, and I made my case with all the strength I could. I believe that I was right. I think I made a strong case. I think history will deal kindly with this campaign and with the record that it made. I think the Democrats made that choice with their eyes wide open. I believe they made the right choice. I don't want to look back there.
Ronald Reagan would remain the 40th president of the United States. He would be sworn in the following January of 1985, and with his inaugural, a whole new election process would begin.
How much do you want?
About a half a cup.
Half a cup. Half.
All right. In the beginning, it was face-to-face campaigning.
Please, Reuben, ask you. Now, where are you from?
The candidates met and ate with real people. No elaborate Secret Service. McGovern's driver was his daughter. They did whatever they could to emerge from the pack. John Glenn began at the front, but his campaign worked about as well as this airplane.
Does anybody have any hairspray?
Gary Hart ran on his new ideas. But when we needed a picture, Hart was always ready. He rode tractors and horses and rafts. Jesse Jackson showed he intended to campaign by his own rules. Jackson carried the race for the Democratic nomination to Syria, to the White House lawn, and to Cuba. Some things Jackson did turned folks off, and some things turned folks on.
Moving on up!
Both ways, Jesse Jackson added a page to American history. Mondale gave television some of its best moments.
When I hear your new ideas, I'm reminded of that ad. Where's the beef?
There's just been about a 6-minute speech, all of it baloney.
Mondale slugged it out to the end with Hart and Jackson. And when he needed a masterstroke, Mondale came through.
Vice President, it has such a nice ring to it.
She's a woman for the woman. She's a woman for us all.
She, too, was a new page of American history. Meanwhile, the Reagan team gave out daily reminders. They knew the value of the White House and the techniques of television. For Mondale, the music was a little thinner, but he battled his deficit in the polls with a positive attitude.
You can stuff those polls.
Reagan campaigned as a combination statesman and common man. Reagan, the master of the photo op.
It's been a long time since I've been allowed to do this.
All the while, Reagan and Bush made it obvious. They liked their jobs, and they liked the perks that go with the job.
Yes, ma'am. Right here's lady.
George Bush? Well, he gave us this unforgettable moment.
Yes, right. Second row, next to the guy in the blue shirt, holding her left hand up. It's a he. Sorry about that. You got to be careful. I'm very sorry.
And that's how campaign 1984 looked on television.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
The office of President of the United States.
And will to the best of my ability preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. So help me God.
My congratulations, sir.
And we hope to join you in a few years as we look back at Election 88. It's a scary thought. I'm Jim Heath. Thanks for joining us as we continue to celebrate America right here on the Heath Broadcasting Organization. Good night.